And a lot of people get really excited about this time mm-hmm. when we suddenly arrive yep. at the Dinosaur Museum. Mm-hmm. And Marcus Ross, I mean, what a really great guy to work with. He's really got a lot of energy and excitement, and I think that's why he's such a popular professor at Liberty. But his job was to explain this fossil record. So, okay, if we've got the layers, so what do you make of all these fossils right. in it? Yep. And how do you sort this out? Also a contentious issue mm-hmm. that creationists understand a lot, and there are things they don't understand. Yep. And so we talked about some of these things.
We went to the dead zoo,
and I think, again, that's an interesting point. He often talks about, well, before the flood, those dinosaurs would have fallen up here in the Mesozoic. And we didn't look at the Cenozoic dinosaurs. He does it because he holds the flood boundary to being just with the dinosaurs and below. But I think that he brings up so many interesting points, this issue of trackways. So I went, and the way that I often research this is I would go to the secular literature and say, well, what are they saying on this? So this is very interesting. You look at these trackways, I found all those dates out of the secular literature. This was not creationist works. These are the idea of the trilobites, the Crusiana, and the 10 million years to the first trilobites in the Cambrian. That's in there. The issue of these amphibians, that's been found in Poland. So those 35 million years and the 10 million, this is all based, and I mean, it's just out there in the literature. Most people don't know this, mm-hmm. but he said this is over and over and over again, not just those three. There are many, many instances where the trackways come before, mm-hmm. and if you're going to take that there's millions of years before the fossils. Mm-hmm. Well, this is extraordinary. Yeah. I mean, this is, again, it strains the credibility of how this would right. actually happen. Yep.
Remember, this didn't make the film, but we were with him up in Deadwood.
In Deadwood, that's right, in South Dakota. And we right. actually saw and the Crusiana, those yeah.
And we looked at those little trackways of the trilobites.
You can see them. You can see where the rock's falling off. It's very flat.
Right. And there are lots of those little trackways, but there are no trilobite fossils in there.
Nope. No.
And that's what he was explaining. He said, we see these are the layers where we see all of their trackways. We don't get to see the trilobites till we get to the layer above, or maybe two layers above.
Yeah, and it's curious. Yeah. And it would make sense that you would at some point find trilobites in these layers. Now, mm-hmm. they haven't yet, but it would actually make sense to really do that. And right. the expectation is that there will be even some, the flood model provides a lot of explanations for additional anomalies that mm-hmm. will be found.
Right.
That you're going to find these anomaly structures that are out mm-hmm. there. And I think that gets into the question then of these layering and the putting the fossils in the mm-hmm. layers, which is that ecosystem, the sorting of the ecosystem or ecosystem mm-hmm. Of the different flora and fauna mixtures mm-hmm. from the Cambrian and moving forward. Yeah. That these are not periods of time, but are different ecosystems.
Right.
And it's a very robust model because when you look at the Cambrian, it just appears. And I went and checked out of the library one of the best books on the Cambrian explosion right now. It's a secular book. But I think they get to about chapter 11 and they're trying to explain this. Well, why don't you have anything below? And the title of the chapter is talking about ghosts. Well, there must be ghosts down there because we know there need to be other animals, but we don't find them. Mm-hmm. So the ghosts must be there. And so I thought, now this is fascinating. This is a very graduate level scholarly work, and they're talking about ghosts. Mm-hmm. And they say that, well, you creationists are making stuff up. I think that there's a reasonable point when you start looking at the data and saying, this really has problems. Mm-hmm. You know, the Cambrian, and you go look at the Burgess Shale, and we included, you can go online and see these images of these really, really complex sea creatures that just appear. And I think that it's a problem, unless you're going to have a view that, well, this just all was picked up during the flood. Mm-hmm. And it goes up and up and up and up. And again, there are the ammonite issues. Well, why do ammonites seem to change through that? And some of these are marker fossils in biostratigraphy. And Marcus and I have talked about these. There aren't always good explanations, but it doesn't mean there won't be, because the big picture is that you see a fossil record that is very clean, as you pointed out. It's massive, and they just are suddenly there. And in many cases, they're captured fully formed in action.
Right.
You know, fish eating fish, dinosaurs in action, fully articulated.
Yeah, the ichthyosaurus is giving birth.
Yes, very curious things happening. And I think it's also important, there are dinosaur nests that are often found in these layers. There are which I think is very interesting, even with Art Chadwick, we talked about that the idea of the flood just coming in immediately is water, but rather the idea of that this is going up and grabbing things and moving back, exposing areas where for maybe months at a time, you may have had exposures of clear areas where things were able to kind of regroup, and then the next layer comes in. I think that's the important thing here, that our view of the flood, of just this layer of water upon water, that's not necessarily what the record shows, and the Bible doesn't require one or the other. Rather, the idea that you find, in many cases, footprints in places and nests and fossils were in these layers showing you this picture that life was trying to recover in areas and then be taken away. As an area could have been pushed up, you know, covered with water, then pushed up tectonically, exposed, animals come in. Other animals that were killed come in. That's where you get to the dinosaur beds. They float in, they eat them, and then they all come back and get captured again. So I just was really impressed with the complexity of the data, but how the flood model was a very viable way of looking at that data. And I think Marcus did a really good job explaining that.
I think the key thing that came out of that with Marcus and me was the understanding that this was a violent world. And the violence was not, and the evil and the violence, which we normally think of, the fallenness of man and the evilness of man, therefore. But what we don't often think about is how the entire world fell, and that included the animal world as well. And it's easy to see that when we're in the the museum there, and you see the ferocity that's represented in those fossil dinosaurs. In fact, in that one in the Discovery Center was one of the dinosaurs standing over another, and
it's
in a predatory mode, and so. Marcus was talking about the evidence of teeth marks on some of the bones. That this was a an extremely violent world everywhere, not just man, but all of the animals. And that was to me that was almost a new concept to begin to think about.
Oh, it was a major paradigm shift for me, and I bring this up because it brings up this very curious question: well, why aren't there humans in the flood fossils? And I like to Kurt. Kurt has a great comment. He says, well, I'll double down on you. He said, there also is no angiosperms, there are no flowering plants, and there are no mammals of any sort that we know. I mean, you have some very curious rodent creatures in the Mesozoic, but you don't have the mammals. They just appear like that in the Cenozoic. And so this is very interesting from a vertebrate paleontology. So I was reading Benton's book on this. His vertebrate paleontology is the best. And he gets to the mammals and the phylogeny, which is where you show all these animals coming out. Literally, they just are all of a sudden all there. And the question is that, well, okay, so why do you have all these radical body plans, and it's called the mammalian radiation, they just appear. And he actually explains in the book, this is a problem for this view. Like, so where are all the molecular creatures that would have had to have evolved here? So I think what this shows you is that there's a radically violent world that potentially was destroying the good world. And I think this is what Art Chadwick has said. What is the question is that, was there a possibility that there is much like areas of the world that only humans lived in and mammals that we know, that that's what Noah would have left from, and that maybe there weren't that many humans. As Art Chadwick, I think, pointed out, how easy would it have been with the technology they had to kill Tyrannosaurus Rex? And if they worked in packs and you had many of these, you're talking about the age of serpents that were destroying man and would have destroyed all the other creatures and destroyed each other. And so you see this picture of God starting over entirely, which is what he says. And these are speculative ideas, but I think it's important that there aren't any yet found, any human fossils or any mammal fossils in those records, but there's probably good reasonable ways to explain it. But the point of it all is that there's really also not reasonable ways to, that's a tough problem from the evolutionary view as well.
As Marcus pointed out, he said, if these animals are as ferocious as they appear to be, then, you know, I would not see myself with the Triceratops as a pet. You know, I wouldn't have one in my backyard, and I wouldn't live near one. And so just from that practical perspective, it is highly possible that wherever dinosaurs were, people weren't.
That's right.
And that they wouldn't be.
That's exactly right. And other animals would not live there. Right. And I think as well, you get a picture that even the mammals that existed, and this is the point that often is made, are not the mammals that came afterward, because we get this with Todd, that they diversified later. There's a plasticity in the animal, the genetic code themselves. So, and again, I mean, I get, and I'll end with this, you just take one thing, bats. So when bats appear in the fossil record, they appear very low, and that shows that we have this, the Mesozoic and the Cenozoic. They fall very low down here in the Eocene, the Pliocene, the Paleocene. I get this, those Eocene, those scenes kind of confused. So low, and they're bats. They're perfectly functioning bats with wings and echolocation and all the things we think of a bat, and it's right there. And you look again at the vertebrate paleontology, and all the animals in the phylums just appear. And he even says this, this phylogeny is kind of intractable, and how do we explain where all these common ancestors came from? Because you don't see common ancestors in the record. They're just there. Which would lead very much to this picture that there was a bunch of animals kept on the ark and got off at some point and then began to re-diversify.